We've been dealing with the personality of Joseph as a person that came to reign. Joseph came to reign. Joseph is a type of person in the Bible that I say that every one of us can identify with. He suffered so many painful. Some of the things that he suffered were very unjust. And so if you feel that you are suffering, you know, unjustly, you can identify with Joseph. Joseph suffered rejection by the very people that he called his brothers. So if you have been neglected, abused, rejected, misused by either the people you love and you cherish, you can also be able to identify with Joseph. Praise the Lord. Are you with me tonight? And so you will have Joseph, you know, went through so many. He was sold as a slave. He was deprived of family life. He was sold as a slave. He was taken into a strange land where he had to live and walk. And so if you're walking too much and earning little and not getting paid and life is not, you know, glorious for you, you can also identify with Joseph. Joseph, you know, is an embodiment of so many characters and natures and things that we suffer in life. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. But the paramount thing about Joseph is that upon all what he suffered, he came to reign. Joseph is also somebody that had a dream. Amen. And everyone sitting out here in this house tonight to have some kind of a dream. Tell somebody, I have a dream. I know you have a dream. You may not have been so bold like so many of us, but Joseph was so bold to talk about his dream. Amen. And the Bible says he dreamed a dream, and when he dreamed a dream, it was a very interesting dream. If some of us were the one who dreamt like that, we would not want to talk about it. But the Bible said Joseph said he had a dream that they were gathering as sheaves or I said you know, the firewood, and there were about, you know, 12 bundles of them, and you know, all the other, you know, 11 bundles bowed before his bundle. And he was talking to his brothers. Amen. Tell somebody, be bold enough to talk about your dream.
Be bold.
Are you gonna speak back to me? Say, tell somebody, be bold enough to talk about your dream. Your dream seems to have failed many times. And the last time, in last year, by this time, you were having some big dreams. And this year, you said, well, I'm not talking to anything about it. What's your plan for 2016? Well, you know, I'm just silent. No opinion. Some of you are like, those folks that say no opinion. You don't want to talk about it because it looks like you talk about so many things about your life, so many of your expectations, and it does not come to pass. Amen.
Amen.
And so when Joseph talked about his dream, he told his brethren about his dream, and the Bible said his brethren were curious, and in his dream did not need an interpreter. Amen. Need too much of prayer, did not need a prophet, did not need a seer. So the brother seems to have an understanding of the dream. So they questioned him and said to him, do you really mean that we, your senior brothers, will all come and bow before you? Is that what your dream is meaning? Amen. Is that the meaning of your dream? They questioned the meaning of his dream. The Bible says, but Joseph had yet another dream. Tell somebody, even if your dream is questionable, dream another dream. Now, the more that we see, some of us do not dream anymore. Because, you know, the first dream that we have seems not to come to pass. What I need to tell you tonight, dream a bigger dream. Tell somebody, dream a bigger dream. Because maybe your dream was too small, so God did not need to deal with it. So tell somebody, dream big. So the Bible says, Joseph dreamed again this time. And this time it was the sun, the moon, the stars, all come down and bow before him. And he talked talk with the father, and the father, you know, understood. He was questioning again. He said, do you really mean me, your father and your mother and everybody that is senior in this family is still going to come and bow down before you? Tell somebody, dream big once again.
Dream big once again.
Talk to your neighbor, say, dream big.
Dream big.
So it's time to dream big. You know, even if you have challenges with your first dream, even if it did not come to pass,
yes,
don't give up. Dream big. Amen.
Amen.
If you dreamt for a two-bedroom house and you have not been able to get it, dream for a mansion.
Amen.
I know you said that's like crazy. You know, I better dream what I can handle. No, if your dream is small, then God is not involved. If your dream is what you can fulfill by yourself, then it is not God.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because every time God gives somebody a dream, it's always outrageous. It's not always something you can handle. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Tell somebody, dream big.
Dream big.
So the Bible said, Joseph dreamed again. And because of his dreams, the Bible said that his brother hated him and plotted against him. And this time around, they decided that they have to kill him to be able to stop the dream from, you know, coming to pass. They decided they have to deal with him. And the Bible says when the father sent him to go and give them food while they were watching over the flocks, they said, he is the dreamer coming. Let us see how his dream is going to come to pass. And the Bible said they conspired. They wanted to kill him, but Judah, whose name means praise, said, why do we have to soil our hands with blood? It's better we make money out of him. The Bible said they took him and they put him inside the pit. And then the Bible said the Ishmaelites were coming to pass. And they said, well, hey, here it is. And they sold him as a slave. And they divided the money. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And he landed in Potiphar's house. He landed in Potiphar's house as a slave. And in Potiphar's house, Joseph still hold on to the dream. Amen. Tell somebody, hold on to your dream.
Hold on to your dream.
Now, I know that, you know, you see, the tendency is that many of us, when we dream and we get, you know, into trouble with our dreams, we don't want to dream again. Yeah, so you get into a relationship, you get hurt, and you now say, this relationship thing is not for me. I said that the area that you get hurt the most, that's where you trade your lives. Mm-hmm. You didn't hear me. If you get your hand bent in business, if you lose heavily in business, it means that you were to prosper in business.
Amen.
Because the enemy does not attack you where you are not prone to succeed. Oh, you don't understand.
Amen. Amen.
The area that you have so much attack in your life is the very area that you're meant to succeed.
Amen.
That is the bedrock of your success. That's why the enemy is attacking you so that you can give up. Because when you give up, then you are vulnerable. You are not going to be able to succeed anymore. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You're not going to be able to succeed anymore. So this is the area that the enemy attacks you. It's the area that you are suffering so much pain. The area you're suffering so much of setback. The area you're feeling discouraged. Some of you sitting out here looking so beautiful and so handsome tonight has already closed some areas of your mind. The gold mine of your life, you've seen it all. Because you've been attacked so much in those areas. You've suffered so much pain in those areas. And so that you just close that chapter. And those are, and when people talk about, say, please, don't talk about, can you change the subject? How many of you have items you want to change? When they bring it up, you just want to switch over. You feel so incompetent because the memory you have is so painful. The memory you have is so disgusting. And you just say, please, can we just talk about something else? Don't spoil my day. How many of you say things like that? I don't want to talk about it. And that is the very area where you need to deal with. Praise the Lord. And so the Bible says, even when Joseph suffered injustice while he was in Potiphar's house and was sent into a man that loved dreams. Even though dreams is what separated him from his father's house, even though dreams is what made him to be put in the pit, even though dreams is what was the very reason that he was plotted to be killed, but ended up being sold as a slave. While he was still in Potiphar's house, and when he was in prison, he still do dreams. So the Bible said the butler and the baker from Pharaoh's palace had a dream. If I was like that, you know, if I was like that, if it was the very reason that made me leave and that I suffer so much in life, any person that comes talk to me about dream, I would say, excuse me, what are you talking about? Dreams? I don't do dreams again. Can we talk about something else? Because you know, if I want to tell you about dreams, I am here. Have you ever seen my face before? Do I look like Egyptian? And they said, no. I said, okay, now it is dreams that make me to be here. So please, just give me a break. I don't do dreams anymore. But Joseph continued to talk about dreams. And the Bible says he interpreted the dreams of the butler and the baker. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Are you with me tonight?
Amen.
And the woman medical said, he said, this is so important that you have the entire clip to be able to understand what God is speaking to us about. So Joseph, you know, interpreted the dreams, and these folks left. They were discharged from the prison. They forgot about Joseph. And sometimes while you are going through things, you stretch yourself to assist other people, to help them with their dreams, and you thought when you help them, they will come back and help you, but they don't.
Amen.
And some, unless some of you, that's where some of you are having dreams in your life. People that you have invested time in, people that you've invested your resources in, people that you've invested your energy in, with the hope that at least if they cannot pay back, they will appreciate.
Amen.
And they do not really appreciate. How many of you suffer things like that? You've done so much and then nobody even said thank you. They just don't remember you. So the Bible says these folks, they did not remember Joseph until Pharaoh had another dream. How many of you ever helped somebody and they never talked to you again until they had another problem? Hello. Doesn't remember your phone number again until how many of you have phone numbers when you see a dream, you know that there is a problem? Because it doesn't ring in the morning to check you, how are you? If I just wanted to find out how you're feeling, thank you for the other day. No, it doesn't. There's no call like that. But whenever you see that number, you are in between, whether to pick it or not. Because every time you pick it, it costs you.
Amen.
Just to answer the phone.
Amen.
Okay, I'm not talking to you. You're obliged to do something about it.
Amen.
And you just watch it ring the first time and watch it again. And because you are a child of God, your conscience prick you, you say, hello. You didn't really want to answer. And the person starts the same story again. And you have to say, tell somebody, do not be weary in well-doing. Do not get tired in doing what is good. Because God says he will reward you for everything. So the Bible said when they had, this time it was Pharaoh that had a dream. 2 years after he interpreted the dream, they left him. Nobody visited him in the prison. Nobody talked to him about anything. So, you know, 2 years after Pharaoh had a dream, and here is this guy coming up. Hello, Joseph, among all the prisoners. Excuse me, Joseph. And Joseph, what? My master had a dream. If I was Joseph, what? The last time I interpreted your dream, you only come to me when you have dream problems. Please keep it to yourself. But the Bible says that Joseph, you know, moved on and interpreted the dream. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Tell somebody, keep on dreaming.
Keep on dreaming.
And keep on interpreting other people's dreams. The reason your dream has not been fulfilled is because your dream is interwoven with other people's dreams. That's why it is God has not denied you the fulfillment of your dream. So you dreamt in 2015. It's not because you have, you know, God has denied you. It is because your dream has to do with other people's dream. There has to be other dreams that need to be interpreted before your dream is interpreted.
Amen.
Because your dream is interwoven with other people's dreams. And this is where many of us fail, because when we have challenges, and what seems to be delays, we just give up dream. That's why you don't give up on your dream. Say again, don't give up on your dream. And so the Bible says, the Bible says that, you know, Joseph interpreted the dreams, and now Joseph is brought before Pharaoh, and Pharaoh makes Joseph, you know, the prime minister in Egypt. He makes him in charge of the entire nation. Hallelujah.
Amen.
His dream has not yet been fulfilled, but his dream is about to be fulfilled.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And this is where I stopped yesterday, because many of us have stopped our dream from being fulfilled.
Amen.
Many of us are responsible for our dreams. God has started to fulfill our dreams, but we have become a problem for that dream to be fulfilled.
Amen.
Because of two things. And that's what I want to read here. The Bible says, and unto Joseph were born two sons before the years of the famine. You know that the dream of Pharaoh was about the famine. And why Joseph was put on the throne was because he seems to have the solution to the famine. But Joseph's dream was not about the famine. Are you understanding me? Joseph's dream was about his brothers coming to bow before him. It has nothing to do with famine.
Mm-hmm.
At least that's what Joseph understood. That was what everybody knew. Hallelujah. But in that dream of Joseph, there was a place that was lost in transit. And that was, God did not talk to Joseph about famine in the land of Egypt. God just showed Joseph the end of it all. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because sometimes God shows the glory that is ahead of us and not the process that we have to go through. And while we are going through the process, many of us give up.
Amen.
So Joseph, in Joseph's dream, there was nothing about the famine. The dream was simple enough. His brothers coming to bow before him. His fathers coming to bow before him. Somehow, Joseph did not know how that was going to happen. But that bow down to him has to do with the famine.
Amen.
And so all of that he had to go through was because he has to be transported to Egypt where there will be famine.
Amen.
And so the Bible says here, since he's out from the walk of something different here, and unto Joseph were born two sons before the years of the famine. So now Joseph is taken out of prison, and Joseph is in the position of a prime minister. And the Bible said, when he had his first son, the fruit of his body, the first test of his royalty, he decided to do something that is unique. And the Bible said, he and Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh. Somebody said Manasseh.
Manasseh.
Say it again, Manasseh.
Manasseh.
Hallelujah. And this is why he called him Manasseh. For God said, he had made me to forget all my toil and all my father's house. And so Joseph called his firstborn Manasseh. Tell somebody, forget it. Help me talk to your neighbor, say, forget it.
Forget it.
So Joseph said, you know, I am now getting ready for the dream to be fulfilled. But if the dream is still to be fulfilled, there's something I must let go. Mm-hmm. He called his name Manasseh, for God has made me to forget all the pain. You see, you are not going to be able to access the throne of royalty if you're still holding back to your past.
Amen.
The problem is that many of us are holding on to the past. Your past pains is the, you see, we call it New Year, but you carry the pains of years to year to New Year. You carry the pains. Joseph said, God has made me to forget the poor, the pain. Do you understand what he said? God has made me to forget all the rejection, all the mistreatment that I suffered in the hands of my brother. All of that, I have to forget about it if I am going to have a dream fulfilled. Somebody forget it.
Forget it.
It is going to be impossible for us to move on to the year of reigning 2016 with luggages of things of the past. Many of us are carrying too much of luggages. Luggages of pains of the past. Luggages of disappointment. You know, do you understand when Joseph said, you know, because he could feel that, you know, so much of the pain, he suffered so much of injustice. And so he was saying, I am going to step out of everything that has to do with the past.
Amen.
You are not going to be able to succeed to reign in 2016 if you are going to hold on to your past.
Amen.
Tell somebody, forget your past.
Forget your past.
You see, the word forget means to erase it so that it looks like it never existed.
Amen.
Some of you are like this phrase, you know, I can forgive you, but I can't forget. No, you are not going to be able to reign with that. That is very, very unbiblical. God said, I will forgive you of your sins, and I will never remember it anymore. You know, so how many of you like, I will forgive you, but I can't forget? How many of you say that? Can you confess it in the church? Let me help you. See, I will forgive you, but to forget it. Tell somebody you have to let go. The memory. Because he says sometimes when I watch people, you know, when you see them sit down and you think that they are talking something so secret and important, they are simply talking about the pains of the past. They have memories of the past. See, I'm not talking about forgiveness now. I'm talking about forgetting it. Because I know you have been Christian enough to forgive. But you have not stepped to the level of forgetting it. Because, you see, you cannot reign replaying the memories of the past. Where God is taking you to, in the memories of the past, will become a hindrance to your future. Oh, Lord, yeah. You see, the place of kingship and rulership need a sound mind. It needs people whose mind are straight and clear. Because you cannot take right decisions if you have scars of the past. If the pains of the past are still working in your life, you cannot take right decisions. You've been taking decisions based on what you feel, because the feeling of the past will still be haunting you. Tell somebody, forget your past. We have idolized, you know, we have put our past in the place of idolatry. That even as it is Christmas, when we meet, we are talking about what happened to you. Hey, Sissy, you know when I remember, hey, that year. Now, you have to be in such a position when people come to you and say, you know, when I remember, say, what? I don't even know what you're talking about. Sissy, why do you behave like that? I'm talking about the thing that happened. Say, which thing?
Amen.
So Joseph said to ask for us to be able to move because you cannot cross over with the pains of the past. You cannot cross over with the disappointment of yesteryears. You cannot cross over. You see, that's why some of you have dysfunctional mind. It's not because you're not born again, but because in the part of your mind, in the subconscious of your mind, there is a pain, there is a memory that is locking somewhere. God said, I want you to do away with every kind of memory of pain of the past. So Joseph called him Manasseh, said, for God had made me to forget my toil. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Tell somebody, I'm ready to forget my past.
Ask
your neighbor, say, are you ready to forget your past?
Are you ready to forget your past?
See, I'm not talking about forgiveness tonight.
Yes.
You are so holy to forgive. I know you. You are too well. You know the strength enough to forgive. But you don't. I'm asking you to step to the next level of forgetting it.
Yes.
I will forgive you.
Yeah.
But I will not forget. How many of you are like that? And you'll be stamping your leg. And you are so good enough. See, Pastor, I can forgive. See, I can really forgive. But to forgive. You have a way of saying it and making it hold on you. Tell somebody, I am stepping out of the past. Potiphar, what does he want? Excuse me, sir, he wants to see you. Okay, yes, Potiphar, what's the problem?
Yeah.
In your heart, you sent me to prison.
Yeah.
And you have looked on, you see, when you don't forgive, you look for occasion to justify. And Joseph would have said, hey, Potiphar, call Potiphar, because now he is the boss.
Yeah.
Excuse Potiphar, sit down here. You know, 14 years ago, you sent me to prison, and I did nothing to your wife. She was the one who came unto me, and you refused to listen to me. And you would have had anger and pain in the place of royalty, and you would not have been able to deal with a sound man. So Joseph had to forget. That's all I want. Forget. Forget your past.
Amen.
It never existed. It never happened.
Amen.
You don't hang around people that boost your past.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
People that come around you and say, hey, you know, when I remember what she did to you, they try to psych you up.
Yeah.
And you say, you were there. So you still have this. I was there. I saw you with my two naked eyes. I was there, I'm a witness. What she did to you was very, very bad. It was very bad. But you're a good person. You're a very good person that you forgive her. But they are coming to step up. They don't want you to forgive. They don't want you to forget it. They are stirring it up. And after they leave you, you can see that you are emotionally disoriented because they have stepped up the past. In your life. Thus we forget it. So the Bible said, you know, Joseph said, God has made me to forget all my toil and everything that was happening to me from my father's house. He called him Manasseh. You are my past. Walk here. And the Bible says, go on to the very next verse. And the name of the second Ephraim, for God has caused me to be fruitful in the land of my affliction.
Amen.
You see, for you to go to fruitfulness, you have to first of all give birth to Manasseh.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot get into Ephraim until you have dealt with Manasseh. You cannot get to fruitful. You know why? You have been a believer for so long and nothing is happening. It's because you are still in Manasseh. Tell somebody, I am moving to my Ephraim. You are still in your Manasseh. You are still living in your past. You still have memories of your past. That's why you cannot step into your Ephraim. He said, the next second word, he said, is fruitfulness. It gives us two clear steps into our realm. We must forget our past so we can step into our fruitfulness. Because you cannot step into fruitfulness with the memories of the past. You cannot move on to you. You see, I explained that a little bit yesterday. I'm going to move on to the subject. I'm not going to watch here with me. You see, that made me to understand that the Bible said when Jacob, the grandfather, and the patriarch Jacob, Israel, wanted to bless the sons of Joseph. How many of your Bible students? Mm-hmm. He wanted to bless the sons of Joseph. Joseph said, Daddy, here are my children. This is the firstborn. His name is Manasseh. And this is my second son. His name is Ephraim. And the Bible says Joseph crossed his hand because the right hand is the hand of power and potential. He crossed the right hand and do like this. And Joseph said, daddy, please wait, wait. I am saying that this is the elder one and this one is the junior one. And Jacob said, I know what I'm doing because I cannot bless your past. The problem that you are having, God cannot bless your past. You have to step behind and leave your past behind and step So while you're standing, it's not because you're not born again. You're born again. You're filled with the Holy Spirit. You are sanctified. The only problem is that you have too much of the memories of the past. You judge everything based on your past experience. When somebody, because you were so hot in relationship, when somebody said, "I love you," say, "Here they come." It's all about the past. You're hanging in the past. You know, because the first time Peter did that, and James did it, and John did it, and now Jonah is coming. What is your name, Jonah? So, you love me. Where do you love me from? And the man cannot answer the question, excuse me. Where do you love me from? The man never had that kind of question. Where do I love you from? I'm Sammy. You say you love me from where? And the man is saying, okay, excuse me. Because you're answering based on your past. You're too full with the memory of the past. A business idea comes and you're very skeptical. They all come again. Money mongers. They will not get my money. The last time it will shock me. This time around. I have mad people all over me. And they will keep my money. Never. Till Jesus, I have become wise. It's not wisdom, it is the pain of the past. The pain and the disappointment of the past. It has nothing to do with this. That's what it is. That's why you're acting like that. Not me. You look at me from head to toe, you think you will chop my money. Not in this life. Come with business. Which business you get? Get business. Excuse me, Mr. Businessman. Let me go to my this 50-50 rand job I've been doing. I'm sure of it. Because you're pretty, it's not wisdom. It is from the pain of the past. That's why step out.
Step out.
From the past. You cannot reign with the memories of the past. Now, I've seen people like that. You come to them fresh, they look at you. So, the way they, if you see their mood, you are discouraged to speak. I have this business to discuss with you. He did. Make it very fast. Go straight to the point. How much is it? You are ready. Your defense is already standing. How much do you want? Yeah. I don't have that kind of money. He didn't even mention the amount. You have said, I don't have any kind of money. Because you're operating from the past.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Unless we step out of our past and leave Manasseh, we cannot go on to our Ephraim.
Amen.
Joseph had to understand this to be able to reign. His dream has not been fulfilled. This was a preparation for the fulfillment of the dream. Are you understanding me? His dream has not been fulfilled. His dream is about to be fulfilled. Let me get there because I don't have time. This is going to be a midweek service. I don't have time. Let me get there quick. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at Genesis 42. His dream is about to be fulfilled. But he had to deal with the past and give birth to the future, to fruitfulness. He has to do that. And now when Jacob saw, that there was corn in Egypt, Jacob said unto his sons, "Why do you look one upon another?" And he said, "Behold, I have heard that there is corn in Egypt. Get you down thither and buy for us from thence, that we may live and not die." This was a general finding. What would be it? And Joseph. Thank you. the sons of Israel came to buy corn among those that came, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. What would mean? And Joseph was the governor of the land, and he was he that sold to all the people of the land. And Joseph, brethren, came and do what? And bow. It's just a that is the fulfillment of the dream. But before the dream can come to fulfillment, it has to step from the past.
Amen.
God has to prepare you. You see, where you are going to, you cannot carry these luggages of the past.
Amen.
Because in the position of running, you have to operate from a sound mind.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So Joseph has to be delivered from the pains of the past. He has to forget the past completely and leave it behind. So now the dream is being fulfilled. Who has appeared before them? Is his brothers. Just like the dream said, they bowed before him. They did not know. Look, let me read it for you. Bow down themselves before him with their faces to where? To the earth. And Joseph saw his brethren and he knew them, but made himself strange unto them and spake roughly unto them. And he said to them, where are you guys from? And they said, we're coming from Canaan, sir, to buy food. And Joseph knew his brethren, but they did not know him. The people that has hurt you in the past, when you forget them, they will come and bow before you. They will not even know you again. Where God is taking you to, they will not even recognize you.
Amen.
Because they least not expect you to be there. They don't expect you to reach that level.
That's right.
Because they thought they had finished with you.
Yeah.
They thought that they had closed you down.
Yeah.
Because they took you in business, the first, second business, they finished your money. Now they thought that it was over with you. They don't know that it was not over, that they were helping God.
Yeah.
And Joseph remembered the dream. Did you see that? Which he dreamed of them. Say, you guys are spies. And they said, sir, no, we are not. They even begin to confess. Watch this. They start confessing. I love this place. And they say, no, my Lord. Who is Lord?
Yes.
But to buy food, we are your servants. We're coming in to buy the money. It's not that we are not spies. We never go to school at all. We just come to buy the money. That's all. And he said unto them, go out. No, but you are spies to see the nakedness of the land. That's why you guys are here. And they said, let me tell you everything about myself.
Yeah.
Thy servants are 12 brethren. The sons of one man in the land of Canaan. They start telling their story.
Yeah.
Who are they telling the story to? Watch this. Son of one man in the land of Canaan, and behold, the youngest is this day with our father, and one is not. Who is that one that is not?
Joseph.
And Joseph said unto them, that is it. I speak unto you. Stop the story. Don't forget about the story. You people are spies. Because they say they are 12, and this youngest one is with the father, but the other one, we don't know, lost. And they're speaking to the one that they call it. So you see, you have to be prepared for this kind of situation. You have to be prepared that when God promotes you to the place of royalty, that you don't have any pain. When you see those who hurt you when you were down coming to you, you will be looking at them. You don't have any pain in your heart. Joseph did not have any pain. He was just playing with them.
Yeah.
He was just playing mind games with them. Because he did not want them to know who he was. Hereby shall you be proved. were just the two of them from the same mother.
Yeah.
Rachel, the love of Jacob's life. So he's eager to see his junior brother. So he prayed and he said, "You people are spies. You are not going anywhere. Unless you bring that young, you say, where are you from? We are from Canaan, son. And we were 12. One is not here. We don't know what happened. But the younger one, we can give you our whole family. We are not spies." Joseph said, "Okay, you guys are going to go bring that young one here. Unless you bring that young one here, you know, you guys are in big trouble here." And he's looking at them. And they look at what they said. They said, "Look at what they think. Send one of you and let him fetch your brother. And he shall be kept in prison, that your words may be proved. Whether there be any truth in what, or by the life of the Pharaoh shall he show you as spies." No, go on. And he put them all together in one word, 3 days. And Joseph said unto them, the 10th day, "These two and leave, for I fear God. If it is true, men, let one of your brothers be bound in the house of your prison. Go and carry God corn for the famine for your house. But bring your junior brother." He is eager to see his brother. All of that is for him to see his brother. His heart is longing for his brother. So they put one of them down and they went. And they put the money back in their bag. The money for the corn, they put it back. Ask the money to be put back. And they put the money back. Now go on, go on. You need to read this story. Because you see, you cannot operate with the freedom of mind if you're living in the past. In the position of leadership, in the position of where you exercise influence and control, you will not be able to. And they said one to another, "We are very guilty concerning our brother, in that we saw the anguish of his soul when he besought us, and we would not hear. Therefore is this thing." They said, you see, they're talking about this thing is because of that brother that we, you know, he was begging us. We refused. This is why this is happening to us. They justify themselves for the sins of their past. They're talking in front of the person that they saw. And Joseph is looking, saying, "This thing is happening to us. It's because we sold our brother. This is why we are suffering these things. That's why this man is treating us like this. He doesn't even know us, but he's offended in us. That's why it's because of that pain." They were talking among themselves, and Joseph was here. God is going to bring your enemies to the place where they will come face in front of you, and you will still have peace. Some things that are like mystery in your life is about to be revealed. You will have answers. But before God say, because some of you, let me say, if God were to reveal who is the witch in your family, some of you will go and borrow corn. How many of you? If God come down and say, "This is the person that is making you suffer," before God finish telling you, he said, "God, don't worry, thank you for even giving me." You go look for matches or God, you go shoot people in your family because you're carrying the pain of the past. He said, "Don't even say it twice. Don't say it twice. Thank you so much. Lord, I give you glory." And the next message is, "Do you know where they sell God?" Because you're walking with the pain of the past. That's why some things are still a mystery to you. There are some things that God cannot make known to you. Because if He make known to you, your anger is good. You have to leave the past behind so that God can reveal some things to you and make you be in charge of all. I have seen families divided because a prophecy said, "This one is bewitching you." They didn't even wait for the service to be over. They said, "Thank you, Lord Jesus. That's why I came to church today. You are the one who's they started. They left the church before the prophecy could end. They get to the house and they hold God up. "You are the one bewitching us. Pastor has said everything. You are..." Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Jesus. And God just and they said, thank you. And God has exposed you.
Yeah.
I know I have been suspecting you. So much pain, but because he has walked away from the pain of the past, he could play them without any high feelings. He was not painful. He did not feel a sense of revenge, but he felt a sense of sympathy.
Amen.
He was sympathetic concerning. You will see now. Let me run through this. And Reuben answered them, saying, "Did I not tell you, saying, do not sin against the child? And you will not hear him start blaming each other. Therefore, behold, also his blood is required." Everybody, didn't I tell you people to do not do anything to that child? How many years ago? Several years ago. God is, in 2016, God is about to, you know, take you to the place that you will access information that was the reason why things were happening the way they were happening in your life. And God is not giving you that for revenge. He's giving you that so that you can deal with it.
Amen.
Because, you know, some of you, some questions in your life has not been answered. Those questions, those lifelong questions, you're wondering, why is this? Why is that? Why is this? Is about to be answered in 2016. But God is not going to give you access to such information if there is pain of the past with you. Because you are not going to be able to handle it.
That's true.
You're going to look for where they are selling guns and become a terrorist in your family. And they knew not that Joseph understood them, for they speak to them by interpreter. They were speaking Hebrew, and they thought they were speaking before an Egyptian. They are talking in front of Joseph, and Joseph is listening to them. Because Joseph was speaking to them through an interpreter, they did not know that he understood their language. So all this, they're speaking among themselves. And Joseph is standing there, and he's understanding everything. God is going to bring everything that was secret in the past of your life. Everything that was a mystery is about to be exposed. Because you're coming to the position of reigning, and you have to have all the information that you need to be able to reign. So God is, but you cannot do that. Forget your past. Talk to your neighbor, say, forget your past. Talk to your neighbor, say, forget your past. And he turned himself about from them and wept and returned to them. He went in and cried. Not for, he was having pity. You will see at the end of the day, when he spoke to them, he did not speak from the position of anger. He did not speak from the position of pain. He spoke from the position of sympathy. Not from the position of anger. That what they did to you, there are some of you that if you have a reason now to see one of your enemies, you will kill them. Some of your brain fall down and die, fall down and die, fall down and die. And you're standing up and leaving, standing up. And you feel frustrated in your prayer life. Because your enemy has not died. How many of you have some enemies that you wish they were dead? Just be true in church. Lift up your hand, you have some enemies that you, that if it's not because of God, can I have many people in the church? If it's not because of God, you will just ask them to die. And they will just die. If God were to give you power. How many of you have this kind of enemies? Thank you. You are many people like me. If not because of God. My mother used to tell me when I do nonsense, she said, let me go to church and come back. If today is not church, then they postpone the punishment because it's Sunday for you. Not that they forgive you, they only postpone it. You thank God today is church. You thought that it's over, but Monday they beat you for the same thing. And the Bible says, and he went out and communed with them and said, took from them Simeon and bound him before their eyes. So they take Simeon in. Then Joseph commanded to fill their sacks with corn and to restore every man's money into his sack and to give them provision for the way. Thus did he unto them. He did not charge them the money. If I was you and you were me, operating from the position when you were still in Manasseh, the price of corn would have increased.
Yes.
Yeah. But the Bible said he returned their money, he refunded their money, and still give them extra provision. He showed them goodness. He did not take the money from them. He gave them the food. He, you know, gave them extra for their way. That's how you can treat people that has hurt you in the past. Only if you have moved from Manasseh to Ephraim. But if you're still living in Manasseh, in the pain of the past, you cannot have that kind of mindset. You will not be able to do it. They, at least they are not confessing in front of you. You would have said, so you people are not confessing. You see, I told you, my God is alive. They were confessing before him, but he felt no pain but sympathy for them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Tell somebody, leave your past behind.
Leave your past behind.
And as you lay the past and departed, as one of them opened his sack to give his ass provender in the inn, he expired his in his sack, and their heart felt them. He saw the money, and they begin to be afraid. Say one to another, go on. What is this that God has done unto us? And they came unto Jacob, their father, unto the land of Canaan, and they told him all that they felt. They came back and they told the father. Now the father refused to let Benjamin go. The father refused. So they ate the food, and the food finished. So now they have to go back. The father said, you guys have to go back. And they said, the man has said, he does not even want to see us unless we bring it. And Jacob said to them, why did you people talk me the story? He said, well, the man said we are spies. We have to declare everything, who we are and where we come from and our family details so that he can allow us. Jacob was concerned. He did not want Benjamin to go. And the Bible said, Judah stepped in and said, okay, at the expense of my life, I guarantee you, my father, if, you know, let me be a surety that nothing would happen to Benjamin. So they took Benjamin and they went. I want to cut the story short because I'm about to close. But what would we hear? Because, see, you need to understand the dynamics of how the dream is about to be fulfilled. See, why your dream is not being fulfilled? Because you're still living with the pain of the past. If God, there are some of you, if God give you enough money, your neighbors will be suffering. Hello.
Amen.
Because of what your neighbors will, your whole locality will suffer because of you. If God give you money. Because of what you suffered in that locality. Nobody will eat your own rye in that neighborhood. So God has withheld the money. Because your dream is not only for you. Your dream is bigger than you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There are some of you, if God give you a car, you will see your, when you see the people that are ready, blow the water when there is nothing to blow and get them saved. Hello. Just see the people that you don't like. Get out of the way. Even if it is raining, you wind down the glass, you look, press the button, the glass go up in the glass. That's why God has not released the dream to you. Because of the pains that you're carrying.
Amen.
Once you lose the pain, once you forget about the past, you're about to enter into the new future. Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say amen? Let's look at, I think Genesis 44 now. Let's quickly move. I want to get over this. 44, let's look at from verse 12, I think so, if I'm not mistaken. Okay, I think I'm jumping. Let's look at 43. I want you to follow this story, because this is the end of this story. I want you to follow this story. And the father was so in the land again. This is, I've told you, the father has the heart to go up again. Go on. Move fast. Okay. And they took double the money. Now they're going back. So the father said, okay, they didn't take them the first money, so carry that money of the former one. And the second one, we don't want any problem with these people. So they take double the money. And the money that was brought again in the mouth of the stars, carry it again in your hand. But arrange it was an oversight in case they make a mistake, so that you don't get into trouble. I want the children to be back. And take also your brother and arise and go again unto the man. And they don't know who the man is. And God Almighty give you mercy before the man, that he may send away your brother, your other brother and Benjamin. If I bereave of my children, I am bereaved. And the men took that present and they took double the money in their hand, and Benjamin and rose up and went down to Egypt and stood before Joseph. And when Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to the ruler of his house, bring this man home and slay and make ready, for this man shall dine with me at noon. He took them out for lunch.
Amen.
The people that hurt you,
you're
going out with lunch with you. Even your neighbors will advise you, what are you doing? What are you doing? Is your Christianity that bad that you can't stand that? The people that wanted to kill you, you're taking them out for lunch.
Amen.
Even your very good enemy will come to you. What are you still doing with that man? I saw it was entering your car. You mean you allow him or her to enter your car? You never learn. What's the problem? Never learn. I don't know when you will learn. You never learn anything. He took them out for lunch. He said, prepare. I'm going to have lunch with these people. Watch this. And the man did as Joseph did, and the man brought the men into Joseph's house, and the men were afraid. This the January you're going to take your worst enemy for lunch. His food will be making like this. You take him to buffet, so you know you not to your house, so that because you know he won't come. He said, come, let's go to buffet. Let's go for lunch. He said, I enter, let's go for lunch. Take him to buffet. Sit down. He will be holding his food. So he's not suffering from anything. It is your presence. Oh, Lord Jesus. Because your heart is clear, you are free from the pain of the past. Because they were brought into Joseph's house and they said, because of the money. Now they say, it's because of that money. Hey, we are finished. That they will return in our sight at the first time and be brought in, that he may seek occasion against us and fall upon us and make us slaves. Say, it's because of that money. That's why they're taking us to his house. It's because of that money. You know that money that, thank God we brought the money. We will tell him, we did not eat it. Here it is. They were ready to give him the money back. They did not know it is out of love. Because he has left Manasseh. Ah, Jesus. And they said, nobody asked them. They are the one talking now. Nobody asked them, watch this. And they said, oh, sir, we came indeed down at the first time to buy food. And it came to pass, when we came to the inn, we opened our sacks and behold, every man's money was in the mouth of his sack. Our money in full weight, and we have brought it again in our hand. They said, sir, you know, that time we came. We find money, we bring it back. All of us, we bring it back. We didn't touch anything, sir. No, who's asking them? They only ask to be taken for lunch. When you take your enemy for lunch, you begin to confess the things that you say. And he said, watch this, go on. Peace be unto you, fear not, your God and the God of your father have given you treasure in your sacks. I have your money. And he brought Simeon out unto them. And the man brought the men into Joseph's house and gave them water, and they washed their feet, and he gave them their asses provender, and the men ready the present against Joseph at noon, for they heard that they should eat bread there. And when Joseph came home, they brought in their present, which was in their hand, into the house, and bowed themselves to him a second time. The dream is being fulfilled. Remember one part, sun and moon must come to bow. And they answered, thy servant. And he asked them of their welfare, is your father well? The old man whom you speak of, is he alive? And the answered, your servant, our father, is in good health. He's yet alive. And they bowed their heads and made obeisance to him the third time. And he lifted up his eyes and saw his brother Benjamin, his mother's son, and said, is this your younger brother of whom you speak unto me? And he said, God be gracious unto thee, my son. And Joseph made haste, for his bowels did yearn for his brother. And he saw way to weep, and he entered into his chamber and cried, not for vengeance, but out of sympathy. His bowel was moved. There was no pain again. Are you understanding me? When God puts you in the position to reign, you won't have any pain. Not even when your enemies come around. When you sit in the desk and somebody that hurts you so badly walk into your office, you stand up and give him a hand and smile and say, sit down. When the person sees you, he will lose ability to communicate. He will start becoming a stammerer. Yes, sir. You have not said anything. He opened the door of the office. He's trying to see the director. And who did he see? He said, yes, sir. Good morning, sir. Good morning. Good afternoon. Yes, sir. Morning, afternoon, and evening at the same time. But because he did not expect you. He opened the door and he saw you. Good afternoon. Good morning, sir. Yes, sir. My family is fine. He didn't ask him anything. Start telling you what family. And you're just sitting and say, sit down, please. How can I help you? Say, sir, I can't be helped. He doesn't know what to say. He lost ability to communicate. And they set on for him by himself and for them by himself. Because the Egyptians are not supposed to eat with the Hebrews. So they sit separately. And they said, that's the day. Go to the next verse. And they said before him the firstborn according to his birthright. And see the way they arranged the table, it was a problem to them. He arranged the table for the senior because you know who was the senior. But they were surprised how they arranged the table for them to sit. Simeon sit here, this one sit here. That was a problem to them. Watch this. And they sat before him, the firstborn according to his birthright, and the youngest according to his youth. And the men marveled one at another to say, how did you know who's the elders here? They don't know who's dealing with them. And he took them and sent a message unto them, Benjamin, this was 5 times so much as any of theirs, and they drank and were merry with them. Go on to the next chapter. That's where I wanna close with this. Go on. And he commanded the steward of the house, saying, fill the men's sack with food as much as they can carry, and put every man's money back in the bag. He returned all the money again and gave them more provision. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let me move on. Was it at 44? Let's go down to verse 12 quickly. For want of time. You read the story when you get back. I have taken time to read the story. Verse 12. It passed. And it says the bag. Now he put the golden cup inside the Benjamin's bag and let them go. And he sent somebody to say, you guys have taken the cup of the prime minister. Why? Who did that? And they said, no, the man is so good, we cannot do any bad thing. He said, we're going to search your bag. They said, in fact, if you find it, take all of us prisoners. The steward said, we're not taking everybody. the person whom the cop would be found, that is the prisoner. The person whom the cop, they say, if you find it, take all of us prisoners. They say, hey, we're not taking all of you. And so they search the bag. They began at the eldest and left the youngest, and the cop was found in who? Benjamin's son. You know the Benjamin. You know how Jacob is going to feel. Then they rent their clothes and they led every man their asses and they returned to the city. And Judah, the man who took guarantee, and his brethren came to Joseph, for he was yet there, and they fell before him on the ground the fourth time. And Joseph said unto them, what thing is this that you have done? Did you guys not know that a man as I can certainly know things divine? And Judah said, what shall we say unto my Lord? What shall we say? Or how shall we clear ourselves? God has found out the iniquity of thy servant. They begin to confess. Behold, we are my Lord's servant, both we and he also whom the cup is found. And he said, God forbid that I should do so. The cup is found, he shall be my servant. His father is the one to be the servant. Every one of you can go. He wants his brother to stay back. He wants his brother to stay back. Then Judah came near unto him and said, my Lord, let me your servant speak. I pray thee, speak in the Lord's ears, and let not thy anger burn against thy servant. For thou hast even as Pharaoh. My Lord asked his servant, saying, have you a father or a brother? And we said unto him, we have a father, an old man, and a child of his own age, a little one, and his brother is dead.
Amen.
Who is dead? He said, telling you that people that thought that you were was over with you when they see you. So you're still alive?
Yes.
I thought you were dead. They said you were dead. He said, I'm not dead, I'm alive.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
A little one and his brother is dead, and he alone is left of his mother, and his father loves him. Go on. And thou say, bring unto thyself and bring him down unto me, that I may set my eyes upon him. And we say unto my Lord, the lad cannot leave his father, for if he lives, should leave his father will die. And thou say unto thy servant, except your youngest brother come down with you, you shall see my face no more. And it came to pass, when we came up to thy servant, my father, we told him the words of my Lord. And our father said, go again and buy us a little food. And we said, we cannot go down if the youngest brother be not with us. Then we will go down. For if we may not see the man's face, except the younger brother be with us. Go on. And thy servant, my father, said unto us, you know that my wife gave me two sons. And the only and the one who went out from me, and I said, surely he is torn in pieces, and I saw him not since. If you take this also from me and receive before him, you shall bring down my great days with sorrow to the grave. Now therefore, when I come to thy servant, my father, the lad be not with us, seeing that his life is bound up in the last life. It shall come to pass when he see that the lad, which is Benjamin, is not with us, that he will die. And thy servant shall bring down the graves of thy servant, our father, with sorrow to the grave. For thy servant became a surety for the lad unto my father, saying, if I bring him not unto thee, then shall I be a blame to my father forever. Now therefore, I pray thee, let thy servant abide instead of the lad, a bondman, a slave to my Lord, and let the lad go up with his brethren. For how shall I go to my father, and the lad be not with me, lest peradventure I see the evil that shall come upon my father? Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Is it finished there? Go to the next chapter. I'm closing with this. I'm trying to read this for you to understand the reason you have to step out of your past. Go to the last chapter, 45, verse 1. Then Joseph could not refrain himself before all them that stood by him. And he cried, cause every man to go out from me, and there stood no man with him, while Joseph made himself known to his brethren. And he wept aloud, and the Egyptians and the house of Pharaoh buried him. And Joseph said unto his brethren, I am Joseph. Do thought my father, is my father still alive? And his brethren could not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. Are you seeing this? And Joseph said unto his brethren, come near me, I pray you. And they came near. And he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold to Egypt. Now therefore, do not be grieved. Do not be angry with yourself that you sold me. For God did send me before you to preserve your life. Everything that you have suffered is for a reason. God has not allowed you to go through it for nothing. You did not understand why you go through so much pain in your life. You do not understand why you go through so much of the disappointment. Why the people that you trusted so much, that were so close to you, treated you so badly. It was for a reason. God is about to take you to that place where you will reign. The purpose of your pain in the past, the purpose of your suffering is about to manifest. Answers is about to come to the questions of why certain things were happening in your life. Joseph came to understand that it was not them. God sent him ahead. For the Bible said, for all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Have you gone through pain lately? Have you gone through disasters in your life that has left you with internal pain in your life? And you don't understand. I came to tell you tonight that everything that you went through, God has been behind it. It may have not been a pleasant journey, but it is a journey to the tomb, that you were in the pit, neglected, rejected by the very person and people that you love. It was because God was with you. You did not die all these years, and through the things you went through, you were in accident and you came out alive. You were in the hospital and you came out alive. You were in broken relationship. You looked like you were going to die, but you were still alive. It is his purposes concerning you shall not be disappointed. I need some folks who understand it, that Joseph said, forget about anything. It's not about you. God is the one who was doing it for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said, for the famine is just 2 years. Many other 5 years is yet to come. He will look at the person and say, "Are you looking for a loan of 10,000? That is not going to be enough. I will give you 20,000 as, you know, as a seed. I'm not going to ask you to pay back. I will bless you with that." And the person will sit on the chair. He will not be able to stand. Not because his leg is failing him. You know, he's glued. Because your kindness is about to affect someone. You don't understand. He came to you and he saw you that you are the person in charge. His mind said that, today is my worst day. Is that same person that, you know, I know I won't get it. I know I won't even get anything. You know, he's the one there. You know, he believed he won't get anything. But when he comes back, says, sit down. How much were you applying for? Say 10,000. It's okay. You know what? I have decided to give you 20,000, not as a loan. I just want to bless you. And you will not be able to stand up. You will not know how to thank him. You tell him, okay, it is over. Here's the one you go. You left him, he will be sitting down, he can go. Not because there's no tea on the chair, but because your kindness has become for all Lord Jesus. Your influence, that is how to exercise influence and authority. You don't do it, you didn't slap him, you just bless him. There's a way you're going to, God is going to put you in a position of influence and control. That when you see people that hurt you, you bless them. They will not be able to sleep. There's a punishment for the enemy. It's not to retaliate, it's to bless them. That's why the Bible says, bless them that curse you. Because when you bless them, they cannot sleep. They don't find a reason that why you're doing what you're doing. That's how to deal with the enemy. He said, forget about it. You know, have lunch with me. I am your brother, Joseph, whom you sold. Forget about any of those thoughts. The famine is just 2 years. You know, go and bring your father. Go and bring everybody here. I will take it. And the Bible said, redemption in the wind, not with their foot, the wind with wagons. They had cars. They came back with a convoy to take their father. They were tricking. Are you going to see your enemy? God is going to put you in a position today that when your enemy comes, when people that hurt you in the past shows up, you will bless them. They will go back and tell the story. You don't understand what I'm saying. See, God is about to cause you to reign. But you need to step out of your past. Tell somebody, step out of your past. Forget about your past. Forget about your past. Stand on your feet tonight. Jesus, forget about your past. Step out of your past. No matter how painful it is, no matter what they may have done against you, step out of it. Forget your past and move on to your fruitfulness. Lift up your hands tonight. I'm speaking to somebody tonight. If there are people in the house tonight who have scars, you see, this is not a call to be born again. This is a call to reign. It's a call to reign. If there's somebody in the house here tonight who's having pains, who has been so wounded, who has been so maltreated, whom circumstances and situation of life have been so bad, whom people have misused, abused, and you came here tonight, and then you're struggling with the news, a pastor, you don't understand. I want you to lift up your hands before the Lord God of heaven. And if you can step by this altar tonight and say, "Lord, I am stepping out of my past. I walk away from the pain. I walk away from everything that everybody did to me. I am not crossing over this year with any pain in my past. Nothing in the past that I'm going to hold on to, because I see my future clearly." Joseph saw his future, so he decided before the dream was fulfilled. He said, "House. I will forget all the bad situations of my life. I will let him know." He called him Manasseh. "I have forgotten." Tonight, you cannot cross over to the new year to the pain of the past. I saw it all. But when you are here to talk about it, I'm still having nightmares. It looks to me like it's not real. That I could face that could happen to me. You cannot justify it. But you want to step out of the past. I want you to come forward tonight and lift up the hands before the Father.
I want to be able to see and say thank you.